Good morning. Can I have all the kids come down front for Kids Corner? Well, good morning. How y'all? Do you guys have any animals at home? Do you have pets?
I don't have.
You don't? Did you all get to pick out your animal that you have? You didn't? Did your mom and dad pick it out for you? Yeah. Yeah. Well, I have a dog. I have a dog named George. Maybe some of you have seen George. But George, I didn't get to pick George out. George actually chose me. Do you want to see him? That's George. But anyhow, in 1 Corinthians chapter 28, verse 9, it says if you seek him, you will find him. And that was kind of the problem with George. George didn't have a master. He was an abandoned dog. And so George had got himself in quite some trouble around the neighborhood. People were trying to run him off and not being very kind to him. And I kept walking through the neighborhood, and there was George every morning, and I knew who he was, and I would say hello to him and everything and greet him, and he'd walk with me for a while, and then after a while I would tell him to go on home, and he would go and hide in the woods behind my house. And after a while I realized that George didn't have anybody to take care of him. And so I realized when I started seeing his ribs showing that he was hungry. So I ended up taking care of George. And see, that's kind of what God does for us. You know, he wants us to seek him out so he can care for us when we run into troubles. And that's kind of what George did. And I thought that was really neat that George, you know, out of all the people in the neighborhood, chose me. Because I really needed George too. So let's go ahead and say a prayer this morning, okay? Dear Lord, help us to seek you in our lives and every day. And help us to walk with you. And help us to seek you out in our days of troubles. Thank you. Amen.
Amen.
Come on.
Amen. Till the whole world hears his name. I don't know how many people here have ever met George. Has anybody here ever met George? Lily has met George, because I saw as soon as you said George, she went. Because George is a huge dog. He is so big and pretty. And what a wonderful dog. What a wonderful story this morning about George. If you haven't met George, you should go meet George. He is ginormous and sweet, like a big puppy. If you wouldn't mind, go ahead and stand with us. And we are going to sing this morning, Stand Up for Jesus. Hymn number 657. We're going to sing all verses of Stand Up for Jesus this morning.
Stand up for Jesus, ye soldiers of the cross. Lift high his royal banner, it must not suffer loss. From victory unto victory, his army shall is Lord indeed. Stand up for Jesus, the trumpet call obey, for to the mighty conflict in this his glorious day. Strength oppose. Stand up for Jesus, stand in his strength alone. The arm of flesh will fail you, ye dare not trust your own. Put on the gospel armor, each piece put on with prayer, where duty calls for danger, be never wanting there. Stand up for Jesus, the strife will not be long. This day the noise of battle, the next the victor's song. To him who overcometh, a crown of life shall be. Glory shall reign eternally.
Let us pray. Father, we thank you for this time that we can come together in thy house to study thy word, to listen to these songs praised, and to have fellowship with these people that we love. We thank you, Lord, that you have been blessed this week with many blessings that we cannot count. We continue to pray, Lord, for our pastor and brother and Sharon. We pray for those that have responsibility in our churches, our deacons, our music directors, our teachers, and we thank you for this. We thank you, Lord, for these little children that were here in Children's Corner this morning, that they will continue to grow and strive and become the people that we would love for them to be. Lord, we thank you for keeping watch over our people that have had surgery, and we know that there are many in our congregation that are sick and have afflictions this morning, and we just continue to pray for them, and you know that they will be healed do thy will. We pray, Lord, for this church. We thank you for the recognition that Brother Rocky was given to the people that did the cleaning on the outside and the inside of our buildings, that we could keep it beautified for our Lord, because he expects this to us. He has entrusted us with the buildings along with our need to go and spread the word, that we keep his places looking beautiful. We pray for our people in armed services, Lord, as they are in harm's way. And if we pray, Lord, that if it be thy will, that you would return them to their homes and to their families. We pray now, Lord, as we go into this worship hour this morning, continue to bless the singing. We pray that you would be with Brother Rocky, just put in his heart the words that thou would have us to hear. Open our hearts and minds that we might receive it and take it and use it in the days to come, that as we leave this place this morning, we will say it's been good and to be in the house of the Lord. Forgive us now, Lord, where we fail thee, and continue to bless and keep us throughout this service and throughout life. For us in Christ's name I pray. Amen.
Amen.
Please turn with us to 521. Faith is the victory. We'll do all three verses. While you're turning, I'm going to read the scripture above it, 1 Peter 3 through 5. Praise be to the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ. In his great mercy, he has given us new birth into a living hope through the resurrection of Jesus Christ from the dead, and into an inheritance that can never perish, spoil, or fade, kept in heaven for you, who through faith are shielded by God's power until the coming of the salvation that is ready to be revealed in the last time. Encamped along the hills of light, ye Christian soldiers rise and press the battle ere the night shall veil the glowing skies. Against the foe in miles below, let all our strength be hurled. Faith is the victory we know that overcomes the world. Faith is the victory. Faith is the victory. Oh, glorious victory that overcomes the world. His banner over us is love, our sword the word of God. We tread the road the saints above with shouts of triumph trod. By faith it will like a whirlwind strength swept on o'er every field. The faith by which they conquered death is still our shining shield. Faith is the victory. Faith is the victory. Oh, glorious victory that overcomes the world. To him who overcomes the foe, white raiment shall be given. For that good singing this morning. At this time, please stand for the doxology. Number 668, remain standing for the offertory prayer to follow.
Thank you for the many blessings you give us each and every day of our lives. We come now to the part of our worship service that we have an opportunity to give back a portion which you so graciously given us from those opportunities and the blessings you've given us, Father. We just pray that you'll take our offerings, our tithes, and our gifts to you, Father, and use them in the way that you please. And may we use this money, Father, to help other people to come closer to you. Guide us and direct us. In your name we pray. Amen.
May all who come behind us find us faithful. Amen. That's a great way to end that song. Well, I'm going to ask you today to turn with me to Revelation chapter 2. And we're going to be picking up with verse 12. Today we come to the church, the third church that we're going to be looking at out of the seven. This is the church at Pergamum. Some versions say Pergamos, but Pergamum was probably the more correct. So we're going to start with chapter 2, verse 12, and we're going to read through verse 17. Would you stand with me as we honor God's word? To the angel of the church in Pergamum, write, "These are the words of him who has the sharp, double-edged sword. I know where you live, where Satan has his throne. Yet you remain true to my name. You did not renounce your faith in me, even in the days of Antipas, my faithful witness, who was put to death in your city, where Satan lives. Nevertheless, I have a few things against you. You have people there who hold to the teaching of Balaam, who taught Balak to entice the Israelites to sin by eating food sacrificed to idols and by committing sexual immorality. Likewise, you also have those who hold to the teaching of the Nicolaitans. Repent, therefore. Otherwise, I will soon come to you and will fight against them with the sword of my mouth. He who has an ear, let him hear what the Spirit says to the churches. To him who overcomes, I will give some of the hidden manna. I will also give him a white stone with a new name written on it, known only to him who receives it." Thank you. You may be seated. One summer many years ago, when the children were still very small, we went to Gulf Shores, Alabama for a week of much-needed vacation. We were anticipating getting out in the sunshine, playing out in the sand, in the water, and generally just getting a lot of rest. Well, we did get a lot of rest because the rain pelted down every single day, all day long. Friday morning of the week came, and it was a beautiful day, a beautiful sky, no clouds in sight. Of course, down on the coast, you don't really know what's going to happen later in the day, but we were excited that finally we wake up and the kids were all jumping up and down. They were so excited. At last, the day before our departure, we were going to get to go to the beach. Well, that afternoon, I noticed something floating in the water quite a distance from the shore. I watched it for a little while, and I realized that it was coming right straight toward the beach. Well, I climbed the stairs of one of the buildings nearby so I could get up a little higher and see what it was. But all I could see was this indistinguishable red mass. And my first thought was that it was the remains of some sea creature, you know, that some gigantic sea creature had been mutilated by other sea creatures and it was floating toward the shore. And I was prepared to warn the other swimmers, you know, we've got this, all this bloody gore coming toward us. You need to get out of the water. But then that red mass floated in close enough where we could see what it was. Seaweed. Seaweed. Nothing but seaweed. And a lot of it, too. Even though we were enjoying the sunshine, and we at least got to enjoy half a day early in the morning, the seaweed would keep us from enjoying the water or the beach by the time it got in. Perhaps it had been torn loose by one of the storms during the week, but it floated quietly and gradually to shore until the entire beach was covered with the stuff. And there was more still out in the water. That seaweed spoiled an otherwise perfect day, and there was nothing that I or anyone else could do about it. There's something else that floats off the shore in a figurative sense, gradually making its way toward us. We don't always recognize it for what it is until it's too late. or until the damage has been done. But unlike the seaweed, there is something that you and I can do about this thing which threatens us as Christians. What is it? Compromise. Compromise. Compromise is defined by Webster as the process or result of settlement by arbitration. You know, sometimes you need a dictionary just to read the dictionary. What compromise in that sense is, you've got two people, two parties at least, and they're trying to reach an agreement, and they have differences of opinion on what would be best for everybody, and so this one gives a little and that one gives a little, and they reach an agreement. That's called a compromise, and in that case it's good. But another definition of the word compromise is to make a shameful or disreputable concession. In other words, I give in on something in an area where I really shouldn't. One of the most serious threats facing today's Christians and today's Christian church is compromise. Increasingly, we are being told that we need to blend in more with the culture, that we shouldn't stand out so much, that we shouldn't raise the alarm too much, that we shouldn't preach too much, that we shouldn't stand by what the Bible says too much. We're told there's really not much difference between what we believe and what people of other faiths believe. And yes, I've heard it right here in this own church, our own church. When a church begins compromising its doctrines or its beliefs, it's headed to trouble. Jesus recognized the dangers of the church making shameful or disreputable concessions, and he recognized that the church in Pergamum was inhaling the deadly vapors of compromise. Something drastic needed to be done. Slowly, the false teachings of a few had begun to creep in. Well, the church had two choices at that point. One, they could allow the false teachers to stay, leading the church to eventual defeat in Jesus' eyes. Or two, they could purge themselves of the teachers and the teachings, paving the way for their ultimate victory. Jesus here is making it clear that the way he preferred for this church and for every church and every Christian was the way of victory. Now in verse 17, Jesus tells us what he would give to those who overcome the dangers of compromise. Hidden manna, a white stone, and a new name. Now, every one of those things meant something to those people who read this letter or heard this letter read the very first time. They might not mean so much to us, and so we're going to take some time and look at it. All three of those portray the blessings of eternal life in a rich and beautiful way. The church in Pergamum had been on the way to victory. They had been in the process of joining the ranks of the overcomers. And yet somehow their earlier commitment to remain pure and undefiled for the Lord had weakened. And though they were faithful, yet they had allowed themselves to fall prey to the pull and the allure of the world to compromise their beliefs and their lifestyles as Christians. Perhaps that is where you are today. Verse 17 promises certain things to those who overcome. That verse makes it clear that Jesus expected His church to be overcomers. He expected His people to be overcomers, to be victorious, to not just go along with the flow. But the problem is that overcoming compromise is hard work. It doesn't happen just because. It doesn't happen just because we read the Bible or because we pray a little bit or because we come sit in a pew and listen to a sermon. In this passage, we are able to see that overcoming compromise involves at least four things. And I want to point them out to you in what Jesus is saying right here. It's a good place to look because He says your biggest problem is you're compromising with the world. He says, I want to tell you how to be overcomers. And I want to give you the promises for those who do overcome. They're just as valid and relevant for us today, and I hope that you'll listen. I hope you'll pay attention. In verse 13, the first thing is that overcoming compromise involves facing life realistically. Facing life realistically. Well, Jesus helped them face their circumstances realistically, honestly. He said, "You live where Satan has his throne." Now, we're going to get into this a lot more tonight. I want to tell you, this week as I was studying for tonight, I began to realize that I have stumbled onto something that is an amazing, amazing bit of history. And I hope you can be here for that. But when he said, "You live where Satan has his throne," they all completely understood what he was talking about. Well, what did he mean by it? Well, we're just going to talk about it a little bit this morning. Pergamum was a great religious center. There were two primary gods that were worshipped there besides Caesar. This is in what is now Turkey, and it was part of the Roman Empire at the time this was written. And there was Caesar worship going on there, as we talked about last week. But Pergamum had these two primary false gods that were worshipped there. One of them was the god of healing, known as Asclepius. And people came from all over to worship and be healed by this god. The symbol for Asclepius was a serpent. And people would come. It was like it was their version of a hospital. And they would come from all over to be healed in the temple of Asclepius. And they had these dormitories, and you'd lie down there, and if the snakes, there were snakes crawling everywhere. They were non-poisonous, but if a snake crawled across your body while you were sleeping, that meant that the god Asclepion had looked with favor on you and you were going to be healed of your disease. Now the catch was, they didn't let anybody into their little hospital unless they had a pretty good idea they were going to be healed to start with. But that was Asclepius, and by the way, as we'll see more in more detail tonight, that symbol of a snake appears in a lot of medical emblems to this very day. That's where it came from, was Pergamum. Now, let's keep going. Pergamum, the city of Pergamum, was built on the side of a hill, and at the top of the hill, near the top, was an altar that stood 40 feet high. And from a distance, it looked exactly like a throne on the hillside. And on that altar, worshipers burned incense and made other sacrifices to the god Zeus 24/7. There was smoke coming from the altar of Zeus constantly. He's also called Jupiter, depending on which language, Latin or Greek, you're talking about. But Pergamum was also one of those places where the citizens were required to burn that annual pinch of incense to Caesar and say, "Caesar's Lord." So when Jesus said to them, "I know where you live," his words had special significance for them. But there's one very important distinction to make here, though. In the Greek language, there are two words for live. When he said, "I know where you live," one of them meant to be a sojourner. In other words, I'm just passing through. This is not really where I live. I'm just here temporarily. And a lot of times that word is used in the scriptures to refer to Christians, because we are just passing through this world. And it helps us to keep our perspective that this is not home for us. But the other word meant to be a permanent residence. This is where you put down roots. This is where you're born, where you're raised. And that's the word that Jesus used here. He's saying that they have to face up to the fact that they live in Pergamum. "I know where you live. This is your permanent residence." And he's saying, you've got to do the very best you can under those circumstances. The word that Jesus gave them was not escape, not move somewhere else where it's a little easier to live. The word that he gave them was, be overcomers. Don't compromise. Sometimes we may feel that we might want to run and hide. especially in our world today. We want to avoid confronting the evils of our day, the watchword of many Christians. In fact, I was talking to a lady not too long ago. You don't know her, but she's in another city, in another state, and she was talking about how she just wishes she things the world is so bad. She just wishes that she could escape, that Jesus would just come on back. Well, you know, I think we all feel that way sometimes, but that's really not the watchword for Christians. Our watchword is not escape. Our watchword is conquest. Our watchword is victory. There was an old hymn that had the words, "This world is not my home, I'm just a passing through." And you know, that might be a nice sentiment, and it does contain some truth, and yet the other side of the coin is that we are living here now. This is where we live. We may not see altars to Zeus or Jupiter or gods of healing, but there are other clear evidences that Satan has made inroads into our world and into our lives. A little bit at a time, because we compromised here and we compromised there, and sooner or later it happens. Before we know it, we're not as close to the Lord as we used to be. We're not spending time with Him like we used to. Worship with other Christians is not a priority as it used to be. Overcoming compromise requires, first of all, that we admit that the world around us is not as nice and rosy as we've been pretending. The first step to overcoming compromise is that we face life realistically, the way Jesus did, and that we don't continue to live here among people who do not know Christ, who don't want to know Christ, as though we were blindfolded to what's going on. We need to understand that not everybody's happy about us being Christians. And not everybody's happy about there being Christians in the world. Only when we face life realistically can we be the people that God intends for us to be. Being witnesses for Christ requires that we be honest, that we face our situation honestly. That's what Paul was trying to get the Philippians to do. When he wrote the letter to the church at Philippi, he said, "Do all you have to do without grumbling or arguing, so that you may be God's children, blameless, sincere, and wholesome, living in a warped and diseased world, shining there like lights in a dark place." The world you live in is not perfect, but be overcomers. Shine like lights in a dark place. All right, we got to face life realistically. Number two is also verse 13. Overcoming compromise involves holding fast faithfully. Jesus commended them for their faithfulness to Him. He told them, "You remain true to My name." Wouldn't you love to hear Jesus saying that to you? Boy, I would. Now, there were many times, many things in Pergamum that could cause the Christians there to lose their grip on Christ and on the Christ way of living. And yet, according to the King James, they had held fast to Christ. Now, we understand what holding fast means. We understand what remaining true means. But I want us to dig a little deeper. The same word is used in Matthew 12:11 that reads, "If any of you has a sheep and it falls into a pit on the Sabbath, will you not," here's the word, "take hold of it and lift it out?" Will you not grab hold of it and pull it up? In Matthew 14:3, we read that Herod had arrested John. That's the same word that we find here. He had arrested John. He had taken hold of him and bound him and put him into prison. And the literal meaning of the word is to be strong and mighty, to prevail, to be superior. And so Jesus was reminding them they have the resources to remain stronger than those things around them that might pull them away from Him. They prevailed over those circumstances. And they were on the way to overcoming compromise in their lives. But Jesus also said to them here in Revelation, You did not renounce your faith in Me. Remember the incense to the Caesar? Remember that? Renounce Jesus and you'll be okay. He says, "You did not renounce your faith in Me. Even in the days of Antipas, My faithful witness, who was put to death in your city." Now, we don't know a whole lot about Antipas. But even under severe pressure, even when Antipas refused to renounce Jesus and was killed, they refused to turn their backs on Christ. They wouldn't give in. They proved that it was possible to remain true to Jesus even under the most severe circumstances. There's a legend from that time that says that Antipas was one of the leaders of the church, and when he refused to renounce Christ and burn that pinch of incense to Caesar, he was tied up and placed inside a hollow bronze bull that was there at the altar of Zeus, and a fire was lit under it. That's how they did it. And he was slowly roasted to death. The legend also said that while he was roasting to death, that he was praying for the church. Jesus said about him, he said, "He is my faithful witness." What's remarkable about this is that this was a title that was reserved only for Christ. Faithful witness. Don't see it used of any human being anywhere except Antipas. Revelation chapter 1, verse 5. Revelation 3, verse 14. Jesus is described as the faithful witness. To those who are faithful to Him, Jesus gives nothing less than His own name. But the opposite is not very pretty. Compromise comes as the result of our not holding fast to Jesus. If you don't hold fast to Him, that's where you begin to compromise a little bit. When we turn loose of the things we know about Jesus, the things we claim to believe about Jesus, then we're leaving ourselves wide open for compromise. We cannot be true to Jesus and flirt with the world at the same time. We cannot do it. We have to choose one or the other. And the time to choose is now. We're reminded in Hebrews 4:14. "Therefore, since we have a great high priest who has gone through the heavens, Jesus, the Son of God," here's the word again, "let us hold firmly to the faith we profess." Hold on to it. That's what Jesus was saying here. The more we hold on to Jesus, the life He offers us, the stronger we become. We find ourselves able to face our world realistically and better able to keep on being faithful to Christ. We may never be roasted to death inside a bull, but there are many other tests of our faithfulness to Christ that we face today. So, we have to face our lives realistically. We have to hold fast faithfully. In verses 14 and 15, we have to see wrong clearly. That's the biggest problem we have right now. We don't see things anymore as being right or wrong. We've listened too much to what the world has been preaching to us, and we believe them. Yes, folks, there is a right and there is a wrong. Don't be ashamed to stand up for either one. Stand for the right and stand against the wrong. See it clearly. Now, there were some areas, and listen, if you've been napping a little bit, you need to wake up, because I want you to really catch this. This is the part where he's talking about Balaam and the Nicolaitans. Who in the world were they? I'm going to show you. There were some areas, though they were holding fast to the name of Jesus, they had started to let this compromise creep in. So he compared the false teachings in their church to the teachings of Balaam and the Nicolaitans. Now, to understand Balaam, you have to go all the way back to the Old Testament, to the book of Numbers, chapter 24. Now, Balak was the king of Moab. We'll get to him again in a minute. But he was trying to turn the Israelites away from the Lord. He understood the best way to conquer them was to get them to compromise. And so that's what he was trying to do. So he used a man named Balaam to go and put a curse on the Israelites, to try to convince them to do something different. And they wouldn't do it. Well, eventually they did, and a plague came on them as a part of their disobedience. Numbers 24 is where you can read that story. Now, those in Pergamum were compared to that situation in Numbers 24 because they were being led away after following Christ. They were not seeing the wrong clearly. And this is how it was happening. They were being encouraged. You can see the details there, little clues there. They were being encouraged to eat food that had been sacrificed to idols, which sounds like a very small thing to us, but actually it was quite serious. Because when a man sacrificed an animal in a heathen temple, only a part of the animal was actually burned, maybe just a few little hairs. And the rest of the animal was given back to the man for him to have a feast. And so this worshiper with his share would often make a feast for his family and friends, and it was quite common for that feast to be held in the temple of that god. And in fact, most family parties were organized this way. So the question was, could a Christian participate in such a feast inside a heathen temple? It wasn't so much that they ate the food. Can I go to the feast when it's being held inside a heathen temple? What does that say about my commitment to Christ? Now, I realize I'm about to step off into something. Easy for you to say. I'm kidding, Bill. Somebody years ago said that Paul, the Apostle Paul, was not beheaded because he said something good is going to happen to you. Got your attention now, don't I? It's up to you. You have to decide what you're going to do. It's between you and the Lord. But I can tell you, that very thing I just told you about eating food inside a heathen temple is the main reason you will never find me inside a restaurant owned by a casino. The heathen temple of the casinos. It is the modern day equivalent where people go and worship the god of gambling. They may say, well, I don't gamble when I go in there, I just go in there to eat. Well, Christians in that day were faced with the exact same thing. What am I going to do? Do I go or not? People are going to say, well, you say you follow Christ, but there you are in that side of that temple. Again, compromise. Well, we've run out of time. But I got to stay on track. The Nicolaitans were a group inside the church at that time who said that it was okay to do what everyone else did. So they, in a sense, that's the reason he lumped them together with Balaam from the Old Testament. It's been said that chastity was the one completely new virtue that Christianity introduced to the world. Relationships outside of marriage were accepted and even encouraged. Sexual morals were loose or even non-existent. It was perfectly acceptable and expected for a man to have a wife and several concubines. In fact, the prevailing attitude, and this is almost a direct quote from an ancient document, the prevailing attitude of the day was that wives were only for the purpose of having children legitimately and having a faithful guardian of household affairs. That was it. So Christians need to understand this, that when Jesus introduced himself to the world, when the way of Christ became a part of life for so many people, the status of women was elevated like it had never been before. So the Christians in that day were just being encouraged to just go along with the acceptable standards of the day. Why are you so different? Why are you being so hard to get along with? Well, back in Numbers 24, Balak was the king of Moab. He tried to get Balaam to curse Israel directly, but he wouldn't. But what Balaam did do was just as bad. He devised a plan whereby the daughters of the Moabites would seduce the Israelite men and have them sacrifice to their god and worship it. Remember, the god of the Moabites was named Chemosh, and he was worshipped by sacrificing children. So Jesus was reminding them of this, and he was telling them that even though they had withstood the attacks from outside the church, they had fallen to the attacks from within. In our day, we have to realize what's wrong. We have to recognize it. We must not be afraid to stand up against whatever would pull us away from Him, whether it's the accepted practice of society or not. More and more it's becoming the accepted practice to just throw caution to the wind as far as morals are concerned. Peer pressure says, do it just like we're doing it. Or even, what's the matter? Are you too good for us? And the world seems to scoff at us and mock at a young person who chooses to remain pure until marriage. The world scoffs when a Christian says, I've chosen to live by the standards of Christ. To overcome compromise in our day and our world, we have to learn to see wrong clearly for what it is and refuse to compromise. All right, one more. One more. And this is down in verse 16. Overcoming compromise includes repenting of sin quickly. If we talked about all that and didn't talk about that, didn't talk about repentance, we would have wasted our time. Jesus told them, repent of their sin of compromise. Now, that's important for two reasons. Look at verse 14. First, sin causes us to stumble. And Jesus told them that He had a few things against them because there were some who held to the teachings of Balaam. They were trying to follow Christ and they were trying to live this way. Now look at that word entice. It's in verse 14. Those among them who held to the teaching of Balaam, who taught Balak to entice the Israelites to sin. The word entice of the King James Version uses the word stumbling block. We get our English word scandal from this word that's used here. It was originally the name of the part of the trap where the bait was placed. That was the name. That little piece of the trap had a name. Scandalon was called. And failure to repent of this sin of compromise was like stepping on the trap, taking the bait that Satan puts out there. Or even used to stepping off the edge of a cliff. That very point where you step off, that's the name of it. Second, sin not only causes us to stumble, but it also causes us to sell ourselves. Back in Numbers 24, Balak enticed the Israelites to sin by eating food sacrificed to idols, by committing sexual immorality. That's what it says. The King James Version uses the word to commit fornication. And the word sexual immorality or fornication gives us our word pornography. It literally meant to sell, and it was eventually applied to prostitutes who sold themselves. Compromise causes people to sell themselves, whether it's their bodies or their own values or convictions, to prostitute their beliefs. So we need to do something about this, and we need to do it quickly. And Jesus said in verse 16, repent therefore. And the word He used, repent, is a very strong word. On the basis of what Jesus has to say about their compromise, because He hated sin and compromise so much, they were to repent. And I want you to see that was an instruction given to the entire church. To everybody. The entire church had tolerated the teachers and their teachings. Compromise was spreading like a deadly disease throughout the church. Now, repenting of compromise is a very difficult thing to do. And yet it's so necessary. There can be no repentance without a definite turning away from compromising our standards. No repentance unless we turn away from it. No victory without repentance. The longer you and I delay our repentance, the more likely it is that we will never know victory in our lives. Repentance has to come quickly to deal ruthlessly with anything in our lives that causes us to dilute our convictions. When that seaweed started washing ashore, there wasn't anything that I or anyone else could do about it. I couldn't do anything about all the rain all that week. I just found new and exciting ways to entertain my children. But there is definitely something that all of us can do to stop the spread of compromise in our lives and in our church. We must face life realistically. We must hold fast faithfully. We must see wrong clearly. We must repent of sin quickly. Have you sold yourself to compromise? Have you stumbled? Are you causing others to stumble? So, well, I don't have any problem doing that, but somebody else watching you might. Today, the command of the Lord is repent. And built into that command is the promise that if we repent, we will have forgiveness that equips us for complete and total victory in our lives and our church. So, what are you waiting for? Won't you accept the prerequisites for victorious living? We can't, according to Scripture, we can't have it both ways. We choose Him or we choose ourselves. That's what it comes down to. You see, this whole thing about being a Christian and following Jesus as Lord, you know, when we say Lord, that's exactly what it means. It's not just a word that you tack on to the front of His name. It means that you follow Him because it means that He's the boss. It means He is Lord and Master. Melissa told us about George. Today, I pray that every one of us will be named George. Let's pray. Our Heavenly Father, today we turn to You and thank You, Lord. We thank You, Father. We thank You for loving us. And we thank You, Father, for allowing us the time to dig into Your Word and see what it really says about living for You. We read about these Christians in our church a long time ago, a long way away from here. And we realize that they face the same things we're facing today. Lord, we want to hold fast to You. We want to be faithful to You. We don't want to succumb. We don't want to be the church known as the ones who compromise. We want to be faithful to You. We want to follow You wherever that leads us, even if other people don't understand it. Father, I pray Your Holy Spirit will soften hearts. I pray Your Holy Spirit will move among us, Lord, and draw us to Yourself. Smooth our hearts, grind down the calluses that have formed on them, and help us, Father, to be able to surrender to You once and for all. And if somebody here today needs to make that kind of commitment to You, Lord, give them the courage to do it now. Quickly. In Jesus' name, amen. You come. You come quickly.
really, I'm going to tell you about something really exciting to tell you tonight. When we look once again at Pergamum, we look at history, and we're going to find out some amazing things. Things that you probably have never heard of. I had never heard of them this week. Now, some of you might know them, and you've heard of them before, though that's old hat to me. But listen, I invite you to be here at 6. Don't forget, if you're working in Awana and choirs, I apologize, but I really encourage you to be here for this tonight. It will change your viewpoint on a lot of things going on in the world. I hope you do. Now, one hand for yourself, and one hand for someone else. You know who that someone else is? Are you thinking of somebody? All right. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make His face shine upon you and be gracious to you. The Lord turn His face toward you and give you peace. Amen. Love you. See you tonight.